past 4 years have represented a transitional period for the video games industry, from what it used to be, what it is now, to what it will one day be. And what exactly will it be? Well, I can't say for sure. What I can say is that there have been a lot of new ideas since 2015. For one, established game companies were starting to see the mobile sector as something more than a place for which to promise companion apps and then never deliver on them, or to peddle atrocities like 2014's Dungeon Keeper. So they began releasing things like that Star Wars game that EA keeps talking about at E3 and Fallout Shelter, both of which have been immensely successful, paving the way for more and more games and genres to make the leap. But where the leap was happening most was in China. Consoles were just now being allowed on sale there. Not that it actually helped increase their numbers much, but mobile phones on the other hand were getting really powerful, really cheap, and the games for them were increasing in complexity and popularity. It certainly didn't hurt that China now had the world's second biggest economy, and it didn't show signs of stopping anytime soon. Not only that, but Chinese media companies set their eyes on expanding, and they were getting shares of big Western developers and publishers, some of the newest being Ubisoft and Epic Games. Meanwhile, the publishers were trying to find new ways for games to be profitable, because game costs kept growing, and go big or go home wasn't working. So microtransactions became the norm in most games, usually in the form of loot boxes nowadays, the thing you'd often see mostly in free-to-play MMOs, now being something commonplace in games that you paid for full price and maybe even pay a subscription fee to. And they're not there always for just cosmetic reasons, sometimes they are, simply put, the way in which you play, like in FIFA Ultimate Team. Bethesda even tried to monetize community mods, which ended in disaster in 2015, since it tried to do it in Skyrim, a game that was 4 years old and already had a set community from which the company tried to get half of any revenue they could generate through their mods. It gave up, but not permanently. It will try again with Fallout 4 quite soon and with very little success. But before that, there is 2015 itself. There was a brief surge in the asymmetrical multiplayer genre with Evolve, but it would soon fade, partially because of the marketing surrounding its day one DLC. But it would show up again over the next 2 years with games like Dead by Daylight and Friday the 13th. Until then, in 2015, Electronic Arts was busy making a worse Battlefront game, and was closing Max's Studios after the botched release of SimCity. The genre, however, was still of interest to many. People still wanted their modern city builders, so Colossal Order and Paradox Interactive walked right into the spotlight with City Skylines and took home the crown, and they've held on to it since. Meanwhile, Konami released an unfinished Metal Gear Solid 5, The Phantom Pain, fired Hideo Kojima, cancelled Silent Hills, and generally drew the ire of everyone that ever played a video game. Ubisoft managed to do that a bit as well, but it would soon be set upon the fear of Vivendi, the giant French multimedia company wanting to buy Ubisoft and actually getting its sister studio Gameloft that handled mobile games. So Ubisoft had no choice. It needed to gain popularity, so it actually tried to improve things. Rainbow Six Siege is a notable example of this. It was launched as a very buggy and kind of broken mess, but unlike The Crew, which would never actually be fixed, Rainbow Six Siege improved as time went on. Currently, it is one of the best competitive multiplayer shooters out there. It would be an actual success story in the long tail of the emerging games as a service trend, one that aims to rob users of any actual control over their games, often with few upsides. Well, there was one upside with services like PlayStation Now, the final form of the long-standing promise of being able to play a game streamed from a server on the web with no need to have the hardware to actually run it locally. And I should probably mention Windows 10 as well, an operating system sold with the same lies as Windows Vista, Microsoft even giving out free upgrades in hopes of getting market share of reaching 1 billion. And, well, they haven't yet, so whatever they planned, it didn't go well, especially with the latest updates, which break everything. Windows 10 was basically a manifestation of all the fears that Windows 8 had generated, but now there wasn't as much of a pushback against it. People got used to it. They were bombarded with the idea of things being just worse until they accepted it, which is the main driving marketing campaign for Call of Duty. No, I'm actually serious about this. Go look it up. As for what was the game of 2015, well, that had to be The Witcher 3. Not only because it was a massive improvement in every way over its predecessor, the first one still has some shining moments that are just glorious, but it was a huge, magnificent game for the most part on its own. And most of all, it is the game of 2015 because of the way it was made and sold. No loot boxes, no microtransactions, only free DLC. A fair price, treating its audience with respect, and eventually getting two expansions that put most other sequels to shame. Its last expansion, Blood and Wine, was still considered the best RPG of 2016, even though it was an expansion. It was a game made by gamers for gamers, by dedicated and passionate people, with a smaller budget than the hundreds upon hundreds of millions of dollars that most big projects had ballooned to by this point. Just look at Final Fantasy XV and how much that one cost, and with a level of success that pretty much few other games had. It turned CD Projekt from a little studio in Poland that used to sell pirated games into a legitimate billion-dollar powerhouse working on the most anticipated games in the industry, all with the promise of teaching that industry a lesson about how things should be done, about how you can make games and still not prey on your audience like they were a carcass and you the vulture. And then 2016 came along and gave us a new console generation with the PlayStation 4 Pro. But it wasn't really new, was it? It was that transitional phase that we were in. A console with the same architecture as the previous one, but with a bigger GPU. An upgrade, if you will. A GPU upgrade for a console. Because consoles, they were not what they used to be. They weren't these plug-and-play, just plop in the cartridge or stick in the CD and bam, you're starting the game, you're playing it. No, he had install times now, he had performance issues now, he had loading times because, well, that was a given since they switched to CDs as well, but this was more of a PC experience than it was a console one. So suddenly, 60 frames a second wasn't demonized anymore. Suddenly, 4K graphics wasn't just a gimmick that PC people were going on about. 2016 also gave us the first commercial VR units, the Oculus Rift and the HTC Vive. Yes, I know there were quite a few more, but these were the main successful ones on the PC, though their price scared most people and made them swear off of VR for many, many years. However, the PlayStation VR also entered the fray and proved to be quite successful, a lot more successful than the other ones since it was a lot cheaper. And the experiences created for them have begun to generate a shift in video games. We may see a VR focus in the future. It's uncertain at this point. Things are still in flux, they're still in transition. And those were the few new things made in 2016 because everybody else was busy digging up the past. Nostalgia is a very, very powerful tool to wield against your enemies or to attract your audience. Be they by releasing classic versions of ancient consoles that proved to be immensely successful in spite of their severe limitations, so everybody started making them. Be they by making sequels to old games, some amazing actually, like the return of Doom to its ancient glory to its classic feel almost, or some lackluster ones like Deus Ex Mankind Divided or spiritual successors like Stardew Valley, which was a massive success built by a single person out of pure passion for a game series that never reached the PC, so there wasn't really much nostalgia behind it for most people that played it on the PC, just the quality of the game itself, and it sold amazingly well. Some games were just rethreads of ideas that had been done before, but now with more marketing and better polish to them, like Overwatch, which was essentially a more varied version of Team Fortress 2. Or The Division, that was just another spin on the looter-shooter idea, one that turned out to be a bit lackluster. And then there's the mother of all throwbacks, Pokemon Go. For about 2 months in 2016, you could not get away from it. It became an overnight success, the new sensation, a planetary phenomenon the likes of which we had not seen since the Gangnam Style dance, and it would vanish just as quickly. Mostly because, although it bore the name Pokemon, and that's what the main draw of it was, it was built on top of the bones of a different game that nobody really cared about up until it put on the Pokemon mask. But what wouldn't vanish was the idea of the Battle Royale game. H1Z1 King of the Kill came out and scratched that itch that games like DayZ and the original H1Z1 were just teasing. A zombie survival game where you would take out the zombies, the building component, and the survival component as well. What you were left with was a large version of Last Man Standing, a battle royale, a Minecraft Hunger Games in standalone form, and it would be really big, really fast. But what I can say was the game of 2016 was No Man's Sky. It was released in a really bad state, not just from a technical point of view, that was to be expected from a small studio, but it wasn't even the game that was marketed or promoted up until release, and it was heavily marketed with the full power of Sony behind it. Hello Games' creation was splattered everywhere, even on primetime television, with promises so many that it would make Peter Molyneux blush. And it broke most of those promises. Features were missing, like the constantly alluded to multiplayer, which was even marked on the box and then had a sticker put over it. And the game itself was just a prettier version of the many, many Minecraft clones that had flooded the market, only without any of the novelty. But unlike most disasters of this type that were showing up every 5 minutes, No Man's Sky seemed to be made by people that actually had shame and a conscience, because they would spend the next 3 years turning this miserable pile of garbage into something actually enjoyable. 2016 was the year when people were already cemented into their own echo chambers, making internet discourse impossible, just as Metal Gear Solid 2 predicted. Everything now was a culture war. Everything was being dragged into petty squabbles. Everything was tainted, and nothing productive could be achieved anymore. If you weren't with us, you were against us. It didn't matter who you were, and if you even cared about what stupid thing we were arguing about today. 2017 brought the rest of the mid-generation refresh with the Xbox One X, a name that is stupid even now, and the new console from Nintendo, the Switch, one that would surpass the Wii U quite quickly. But most of all, 2017 was the rise of the Battle Royale craze. PlayerUnknown's Battlegrounds kicked things off, then Fortnite took over by adding base building back into the fray, and also by being a game that ran better, smoother, and was developed by a company that wasn't obsessed with trying to seem like it was the first one to ever come up with the idea of a battle royale game. We are currently still in the trend of the battle royale game, with Fortnite being the biggest thing of the moment. And unlike Pokemon Go, which vanished into the night, there currently is no sign that Fortnite will go away anytime soon. There were also other games released in 2017, like a new Legend of Zelda game, a small budget Hellblade that looked like a AAA game, or a huge budget Destiny 2 that would be soon given out for free because Destiny was still not as good as Warframe. Electronic Arts managed to somehow piss everybody off, even Disney, with the monetization of Star Wars Battlefront 2. Somehow, it had accomplished the amazing feat of making a game that's better than the predecessor in many ways and worse than it in every other way possible. It tried something similar with Mass Effect Andromeda, a game that was shipped with so little interest in quality from the publisher that it killed the series again. Resident Evil 7, however, gave the series a new lease on life by moving it into first person, making it less stupid, and copying the PT demo for the canceled Silent Hills. And when it got a VR version, it became a completely new kind of experience that made people actually take interest in VR. Meanwhile, Assassin's Creed had taken a year off and came back with a brand new idea, that of copying a more successful game, in this case The Witcher 3. Call of Duty, after many years of testing out new things, went back to World War II to save territory to nostalgia. It may seem like I'm speeding through these past few years, that's because I am. It's not that nothing of importance happened since 2015. I was almost dead for a bit there in that period. It's just that I don't know yet where we're going, so I can't say for sure how much of where we've been and where we are will have mattered. The title that would best describe 2017, the game of that year, I would say is Fortnite. It is just a massive multimedia success. It is everywhere. Everybody knows it. Everybody understands it. It's causing shifts in copyright laws, what with the dance stuff. It is an amazingly huge phenomenon. It overshadows everything else, and it doesn't show signs of weakness yet. There still hasn't been the thing to take over the spotlight from it. And Epic Games has done amazing things because of the success. It gave people money back. Developers that were using the Unreal Asset Store to sell, you know, assets, they were given more money retroactively. Epic Games reduced the cut it takes and it just gave people money. And that doesn't happen in the games industry. That doesn't happen. Publishers don't do that. They will gladly even let their own employees starve just to turn a profit and give it to a shareholder. But Epic Games, no, they didn't do that. But if I were to not give it to Fortnite, which I am, I totally am, I would have also considered Prey as well. Why? Well, this was a AAA game made with the, I would say, contempt of its publisher, using a name it had no connection to since that's what the publisher wanted, and being very badly received because of that name, and it was quickly forgotten. And yet, Prey was a throwback to an era of games that aren't about battle royale or fidget spinners about it being trendy, about what's the in thing that week. It was a story with a point to it, a deeper point than its own story. It was restrictive with a purpose, it was freeing with motive, it was a bit dodgy in regards to what it was all about, and a bit buggy, because it's an arcane game. And it was the last in the trilogy of spiritual sequels of old Looking Glass games that they had been trying to make ever since Arx Fatalis. Also because in just a few months, Looking Glass itself, or at least its founders, would return with their own spiritual sequels to their own games. 2018 has not yet ended, from my perspective. There are still a couple of weeks left. But so far it has brought us games like Ultima Ascendant, a title that everybody is calling a horrible mistake that should have never walked the earth. And it is the jewel upon the crown of disappointment that is crowdfunding. Although we got amazing titles like Kingdom Come Deliverance, which would have not been possible without crowdfunding, it too came with a bit less of what it had promised, and Star Citizen is still a few years away from being finished. And for what they're trying to make and how they're trying to make it, honestly, it could use around $300 million. But most of all, many of the studios that people had put their faith in, their money in, through Kickstarter, had given in. Instead of continuing to battle the publishers that ignored them for years, that drove gaming to the ground, that ignored the communities, the fan bases, the players, the people that built gaming, they became a part of them again. Compulsion Games, Obsidian, and In Exile, even Harebrain, are now the property of someone else, leveraging the products built with funds from the public to secure an acquisition from the likes of Microsoft, a company well known for being mostly awful at this point in time. But in the middle of this and other disasters, like whatever happened at BlizzCon 2019, or the unexpected shutdown of Telltale, or the total disaster of Fallout 4's transition to a multiplayer game That was Fallout 76. There was some hope. Loot boxes were starting to be regulated, Nordic Games was slowly bringing together THQ's former properties, renaming itself THQ Nordic, and promising a better future, and delivering on it, mostly, so far. Valve, when not releasing a card game that nobody wanted, was spending a lot of time and money making games run on Linux, driving the numbers now into the thousands and freeing many from the grip of Windows. Well, as long as the games don't have DRM, because the DRM is not going to run on Linux, in the world of game. Then we had Red Dead Redemption 2, which became the second biggest entertainment launch of all time, behind only Grand Theft Auto 5. Every game now was trying to be Fortnite by adding Battle Royale, even Call of Duty, forsaking its single-player campaign, probably for the better. And somewhere in there, Nvidia released the first video cards to have dedicated hardware support for ray tracing, making a dream come true in a really underwhelming way for a horrible performance hit at a huge cost, currently only in a single video game. But that is generally what to expect from the first generation of any hardware. As for what was the game of 2018? Was it the Spider-Man? Was it the God of War? The Red Dead? The Crew 2? Well, no, simply put, I don't know what the game of 2018 is, because the year is not yet done. Strictly from a personal point of view, I'd say maybe Deliverance, maybe X4 that came out 5 minutes ago from when I'm recording this, maybe Synthetic or that XCOM game with the duck, but only time will decide. What's clear is that the industry is changing. It's moving into new directions, into mobile games, into China, into VR, into online only, into game streaming, into games as a service, into a new console generation, and into a future that is still yet to be decided. And the gaming media seems to be heading into the let's bend over backwards to defend a giant corporation's actions because we really don't like our audience direction. We're now in a world that is more fractured than ever. The internet itself is threatened to be broken apart into gated pieces. People's rights to free discourse is threatened, their privacy trampled, people's lives in general are being threatened, actually, as we continue to plunge the earth into a new age of extreme climate, wild weather, unstable politics, frenzied fanaticism, and endless spam wasting what little valuable time we have left on this doomed planet. It may sound like a gloomy outcome, and hopefully it's wrong, but it seems likely. So then, what was the point of this all? To try and give people some context, and most of all to remind people where we came from and why, and what games we played along the way.
For it is the doom of men that they forget.
Thank you.